Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Amari, where we'll be going to our first kind of major new area of the game. So we're going east of the stump to the really, 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 really long ladder.
So we're like five parts in, but I'm just now realizing this. But does Amari speak at all?
Not like on screen, no.
Not on screen. A lot of introspective comments.
Yeah. This is common in a lot of these games where they're taking, oh, the creepy hands. Hands are probably a theme, I would imagine, in this game, or a recurring visual motif at the very least.
Oh, we're getting close to something that we shouldn't be seeing.
Ooh, you're no longer afraid of. If only it was that easy.
Yeah.
Damn. Just fucking Matrix that shit right out of their system.
This is something that they kind of imply in a lot of Dragon Quest games where it's just like you play as a silent protagonist, but it's not necessarily that your character can't speak. It's just that you don't ever hear them speak, which I wish that we had our webcams on sometimes because I'm doing the like, I don't know, head shaky thing, but you can't see that because I'm fucking yeah. Audio. Maybe if I shake my microphone a whole bunch and piss editing Lewis off, that'll give the same vibe. But I go back and forth on that. Like in some instances, like Dragon Quest V, I think it's done really creatively and really well done. And you get some really cool scenes like that I can't even explain the premise of because it's spoilers. Damn it. I'll record that game for the channel eventually. And in some other instances, it feels like, again, I don't want to shit on Mother 3 too much because even though it's not my personal cup of tea, I know a lot of people really do love it.
Is that a space sperm? The fuck was that? Anyway, I'm sorry.
I was just going to say Mother 3 has a habit of telling you by doing kind of what this game just did, where it's just like, it says you're no longer afraid of heights. It'll be like Lucas is feeling blah, blah, blah. It'll often say, which is like the definition of telling without showing. And I'm not a huge fan of that. So I've got mixed feelings on it, and it's very execution dependent for me on how, you know, the silent protagonist is handled.
Well, it ended, so good on you, hero, for making it to the top.
But at the cost of losing Hector, the pet rock.
Yes, we lost Hector, our pet rock.
I'm going to say you're going to hell for that.
We had a pet rock?
Yes.
Yeah, that was Hector. Threw it on the ground to see which way to go. Hector didn't do anything because it's rocky.
We didn't pick him back up?
We did pick him back up.
No, they did.
But it fell out of his pocket on the way up.
They fell out of his pocket while they were climbing the ladder.
Well, you could climb back down and get him.
That's a very long way down. Also, I'm pretty sure Hector's dead.
He's a rock.
Yeah, rocks can break.
Yeah, this but are true. They really dead, though? Maybe we just created 5 new Hectors. And now we've got even more.
Dee, the Hectors are reproducing.
Oh, it has a little space helmet on.
Ooh, Mrs. Parrot.
I don't like that they called that butt certificate beautiful when this character is probably 9 years old.
They're talking, it's her head butt certificate, shortened to butt certificate.
Okay, well, they could have just used the extra 4 characters and called it the head butt certificate.
So yeah, that ladder went all the way to the moon.
I do have, I'm not sure, because I'm not sure entirely how much is just the art style or the aesthetic. But one pet peeve of mine when it comes to an aesthetic of a game is that if I can see the grid-like structure of it, it kind of distracts me.
You mean like the individual squares?
Yeah, the individual tiles of how this game was made. It's very inorganic, which again, I have not played this game. Maybe that is in part a point. But generally speaking, I don't like when I can count the tiles like in a game, because I'd rather it be as organic as you possibly can be.
I think part of that is due to the technology. This was an RPG Maker game. And it's not like entirely tile based, because you can tell that, you know, the way Ryan moves, like he moves, he can move parts of tiles. So it's more like, I guess, Zelda than like the really old like 8-bit RPGs. Where, like, if you press the D-pad once, you move a tile left or right or whatever. And again, it depends on the situation for me, because that doesn't bother me as much when I'm playing specifically like an old game or a game that's throwing back to an old game. What bothers me more is when this is more of an action RPG thing, and it was something that specifically bothered me with Secret of Mana when I tried to play that, was like when you do attacks and then it'll show a animation on the screen and where your character is, and that just doesn't matter. You'll just get hit anyway. That's something more that bothers me with these kinds of... Did we find, like, search a drawer and then find dust bunnies and now they're attacking us?
It's a trophy case.
Okay, that's actually pretty funny.
Also, shout out to Small.
The world's smallest centaur.
The world's smallest centaur, yeah.
Look at all his awards.
You see that... You know what? That actually is really funny, because that's a... The, oh my gosh, I'm gonna break into somebody's house, like, parody of an RPG has been done a million times. That's something that I don't think I've ever seen before, is, like, not just a mimic, but, there's just, like, a dust bunny living in someone's bookcase, and we've established those are enemies, so it's going to fight you now. Like, that's pretty... Oh, her name's Pessy. Oh, I thought her name was Pepsi for a moment. I was like, Pepsi Man's in this game?
No, but Pessy is a big fan of the character known as Sweetheart. We'll be meeting her later.
Well, I noticed the shape of her house is of the anime girl mask we saw in Amori's real life. Well, the headspace, anyway. Yeah. So I'm wondering what the correlation for that is. Or I might be just overthinking
it. You got can. Time to recycle.
Wait, look at that flower. Is that an Undertale
reference? Whoa, ba-ba-ba-ba. So, Ryan, obviously trying to avoid spoilers if at all possible, but you mentioned that the best ending is gotten when you do more of the real world stuff and less of the fantasy world stuff. How is it, like, a bad ending if you go for the fantasy world stuff, or is it just like,
it's a bad ending.
Oh, okay. Ooh. You know, that's interesting, because, and I guess that's specifically the point, because the more, you know, upbeat and happy game will have the more depressing ending at the end of it all. Although I have noticed that there's definitely an attempt to make some of this stuff in the fantasy world uncanny and kind of creepy looking. Like the head house, that we were just in, that thing freaks me the hell out.
No, because it's like, as we've established, just some, again, on a surface level reading, at least for Ted and I's case, is that this place seems like a coping mechanism for Amori. Like, this is the realm of escapism. No different than how we, you know, play games and other shit like that to escape. But eventually, reality will set in. Like, it will catch up. And it will reflect that way on the world by virtue of that uncanniness.
Gold star for John.
Now... Oh, thanks. Again, it's really hard to ask about things without getting into spoiler territory, because, you know, at some point, or maybe, you know, I would like to play this game for myself, or Ted would like to. But when you say good ending, bad ending, now, is that clear-cut bad ending, or is it just a different ending that can be interpreted in a different way?
It's pretty clearly a bad ending.
Okay, because it's not exactly an apt comparison, but so Undertale Yellow, that was the fan-made prequel to the original Undertale, has multiple endings, but you wouldn't call any of them bad, just different. Bad is just a matter of how you view the world and the characters and them. Did you like this or that? And if so, then yeah, this ending would be bad because things happen to those characters that you don't necessarily agree with. And I'm wondering if this game is like that, where it's not necessarily bad per se, but it's a different outcome that I don't agree with.
I feel like more games need to do stuff like that. Because whenever you hear that a game has multiple endings, as gamers, you know, hardcore gamers.
Ooh, with the hard G?
man, with a hard G, John, you can't just say gamer with a
you
hard G.
You said it.
Sorry, jamer. The inherent thought that we have is, but what's the best ending? Can we get the real ending, the true ending? There are very few games I can think of that have multiple endings, but they're all like, you know, the same, or isn't one that's better necessarily than the other ones. And by better, I mean, you know, like supposedly the more complete or true or canon experience, for lack of a better word. In almost every type of game like these, there's an ending that is considered to be the right, true, correct, etc. ending. And I feel like, I mean, it makes sense because you want to give a ending that's satisfying, you know, and if you want to take advantage of branching paths, which is, you know, video games are one of the only mediums that can do that. You know, you want to give the player something to work for that's satisfying. But one thing about art is that sometimes in order to make the best work, you have to do something that goes against the normal, like, what would be considered like true happy ending, I guess, if that makes sense. Like, Romeo and Juliet would not be a better story if turns out that Juliet wakes up and they're fine and they run away together. Like, that goes against the point. Yeah. You know, same thing with, you know,
everybody living after the Titanic sinks. Yeah. Oh wait, they did that.
Wait, what?
There was an animated title.
Now I know the one you're
the one with the rapping dog.
Yeah. Oh,
And the giant octopus.
There was a giant. Oh God, what the
hell? Yeah, it saves the boat.
What the hell's wrong with the world? Oh, it's a wormhole. I get it. Oh, okay. This game's probably developed by an English speaking person at the very least, because these are all like very English pun kind of names.
Yeah.
Well, at the very least, it was localized well.
Well, no, because the way that they're, like, even drawn or designed makes me feel like they were designed with the pun in mind. Like, I don't know what Japanese, if there even is a Japanese term that would have a worm in a hole, you know, like.
Well, I mean, wormhole, though, is also very generic.
Yeah, but there was also, like dust bunny, term. Where the bunny was literally made out of dust and came out of a dirty
shelf. Right. Well, but visual puns are, you know. That's universal.
Yeah, but they're different puns for different like regions, though, is also the thing.
No doubt, yeah. But I think Dust Bunny is generic enough that it can be used across all languages.
The hell is that guy?
He's looking for bold and brash.
Oh, man.
Because it belongs in the trash.
More like, I'm trash.
So here's our first dungeon of the game, the Junkyard.
How intricate do these get?
Not too intricate. Enough to make you think about things, though.
Okay.
Go here, flip switch. Stare open.
So here's the thing. Dungeons have become kind of a taboo thing in the realm of RPGs, I've noticed.
Really? How so?
And by taboo, I don't necessarily mean that there's been like an outspoken like vendetta against them. But if you look at a lot of modern RPGs, Pokemon, there are no real dungeons in either Pokemon Sword and Shield or in Scarlet Violet at all. Dragon Quest XI, there are like areas that would normally be dungeons, like caves and towers or whatnot, but they don't really gameplay wise feel like dungeons until like the second half of the game. In the early parts of the game, they're mostly just corridors with a couple of branching paths. Shin Megami Tensei 5. Shin Megami Tensei is a dungeon crawler series. Like, the old SMT games are all about the dungeon crawling. And SMT 5 has, like, 2.5 dungeons total. if that. It's been much more pushed to, like, open world and exploring. Because, again, and this is one of those things where this is a complaint that you hear from people who don't play a lot of RPGs, is that, oh, dungeons are bad. Oh, I'm walking in a cave and there's a random battle. Oh, this is too long and too hard and blah, 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 blah. Again, I'm not trying to say, oh, you're bad and you need to get good and be a real gamer if you don't like RPG dungeons. I'm just saying more that they're an element of the game that does not translate to a casual audience very well. I'm sure, you know, you all had friends who were really annoyed with, like, the rocket base in Gen 1 or a Pokemon Gen 1 or, like, hate caves.
I have a friend who really hated Pikmin 2 because of dungeons.
Fuck you. You see, okay, that's actually a good point. Pikmin 2 is the kind of problem that many RPG dungeons have, and that, like, many people have their issues with dungeons. Because in a bad RPG, a dungeon is just like a block of space where you wander around aimlessly and fight monsters until you leave. I was having a discussion with some of my friends about this earlier, in that what makes an RPG dungeon good versus not good is very vibes based. Because sometimes you want a dungeon that is fairly straightforward, like, say, Mount Moon. And I'm using Pokemon Gen 1 because, honestly, I think Gen 1 as a whole has pretty damn good dungeons, aside from Rock Tunnel. Rock Tunnel sucks.
I was going to say, you're not defending Rock Tunnel.
Listen. No, but, like, if you think about the other dungeons in that game, though, like, Viridian Forest and Mount Moon are good introductory dungeons. Silph-Co, I think, is actually a really well-designed dungeon because it simultaneously feels like a real place and has interesting, like, navigation, and you have to think and remember things and whatnot. You know, Rocket Tunnel, the late game caves, I think Gen 1 has a really good variety of well-designed dungeons. With that said, you, in a lesser RPG, you will have areas that are too, you know, empty spaces where you do random battles for an hour and then leave. And then you have ones where they go too heavy into the puzzle elements and you're just sitting there pushing blocks for an hour. Tales of Symphonia actually comes to mind with that.
Speaking of, there's a large block in the
way. Oh, man, better learns.
If only there was some way we could Tales of Symphonia, the block out of existence. Yeah.
So, yeah, what was my point? A lot of RPGs have been phasing dungeons out because what makes a good dungeon is so nebulous, and it depends on the game and what part of the game you're in, what was the last dungeon, you know, blah, 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 blah. I don't have a good answer. It's just something I've been noticing.